Number 3, In the Crucible with Christ, 3rd quarter, 2022. Jon Paulien.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. We're starting lesson 3, The Birdcage, in the Crucible with Christ quarter. And Rodney is going to offer the opening prayer.
Our gracious, eternal, loving Father, we are honored to be here. Lord, thank you for this opportunity to come together and fellowship in your word. We invite the teaching ministry of your Holy Spirit to enlighten our minds and lead us through as we discuss your words in the scriptures. We also pray, Father, that you empower Dr. Jon Paulien as he leads out and facilitates, that we may get the truth that will draw us more closer to you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. This is the third in a series entitled In the Crucible with Christ. And it's a series about the issue of suffering, both the suffering of human beings and also the suffering of Jesus Christ and the relationship between those. So we will continue. The first lesson in the series focused on Psalm 23, and particularly the shepherd aspect of that psalm. The second one was about the sources of suffering. Why is it that people suffer? And what explanations can we give? And today, it's entitled The Birdcage, which, just like the crucible, might not communicate a whole lot right off the bat. But I would say that this lesson is particularly raising the question, what is God's goal? What is God's purpose when suffering comes to us? So let's get into it. Number one, and it suggests that we read 1 Peter 1, verse 6, and ask the question of what the Bible means by this verse. What is the intention? So 1 Peter 1 and verse 6.
In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief in all kinds of trials.
All right. So he says, rejoice in all kinds of trials. And I guess the question is, what exactly does that mean? I'm not personally used to running a celebration every time things go wrong. And perhaps some of you feel like that as well. So what do we make of this? Rejoice in trials. What does that mean? How do we do it? Why should we do it? All right, Lou?
Well, I know, just like the story of Job, that anything that comes to me has been filtered through God's love. So when it's been filtered by God, anything that's causing me suffering, nothing can come to me or touch me except through his filter.
All right, Bob?
I think it would keep us from being discouraged, because sometimes we measure our success on how it seems to be going from what you call a secular point of view. Is it working out well? In other words, is there a surplus? Is there a profit? That sort of thing. Are grades going well? But perhaps in God's view, what appears to be a victory may not be a victory, and what appears to be defeat may not be a defeat in the big scheme of things. So I think it's to encourage us that if we're doing what God's plan is, that is the key thing. Although we don't always know for sure, but if we're trying to follow God's leading, he will overall say that that's the right thing. So that still should not be discouraging to us. If you understand your mission is going to be difficult, you say, okay, that doesn't mean I'm failing at what I'm doing. And that can be an encouragement to keep going and doing what you're supposed to do.
So I hear you saying it's a point of perspective.
Yes.
That Peter is inviting us to take a different perspective on suffering than we might naturally do. All right, Rusty?
I've never personally rejoiced because I was going through a hard time or trial, but I have rejoiced that God's with me and brought me through many, many trials. I read a statement one time that when we get to heaven, we'll look back on everything that we went through and realize that it was the best. So I don't really ever being happy about it, but I'm just thankful that God's with me.
Okay. Bobby Joe, good to see you again.
Thank you. I'm the mom of 3 kids. That means that I went through labor 3 times. I don't know what could be more crazy than that. But the day I went into the hospital to have each one of those babies, I was really excited, really rejoicing, despite the fact that I knew that the experience I was going to be facing imminently was going to be really, really tough. It was going to be painful, and it was just going to take everything I had to get through it. But there was something exciting about knowing that when it was all done, I would be meeting somebody for the first time that I'd been waiting for a long, long, long time.
So you are rejoicing in the outcome that you knew was ahead. And I think there's a Bible text that actually says that about Christ on the cross, that for the joy set before him, he endured the shame of the cross. So you have some company, I think, with that idea.
And the verses just before that, in 3 and 4, it explains why he's saying that they should rejoice, because according to his abundant mercy, he has begotten us. In other words, there is a process, a painful process that we go through as we become adopted into the family of God. We don't come ready to be the children of royalty. We don't know how to act like that. We've come like the Israelites out of slavery, and we don't know how to behave with manners appropriate. And so I think his invitation for us to rejoice has to do with that. You have this privilege that you're being begotten into a living hope, into an inheritance. And this inheritance is incorruptible, not defilable, and it's reserved in heaven for you. So yeah, it's something that we're anticipating and looking forward to.
You'll notice the text doesn't say it's fun to be in trials. It says rejoice in trials. What would the difference be in your mind between joy and fun? Are they the same thing or are they different? The difference between joy and fun. So I think sometimes we hear texts like this, you know, it ought to be fun, you know, if we were really suffering rightly or something. Yeah, I don't think so. But what exactly is the difference that joy is possible in suffering? Bobby Jo.
Well, it's my belief that joy is a choice. Fun is what you have when you go to Disneyland. It's a momentary high of emotion, but joy itself is a choice. You choose to see in things the happiness of the moment or of the future moments. You choose to have that attitude. That, to me, is joy.
So you draw a distinction between fun as more of the immediate kind of thing, but joy sees the bigger picture. And it is possible, even in suffering, to have a positive attitude because we trust the one who is with us in the course of the suffering. So that brings us to a number of incidents here. Let's go to number 2, as there were incidents in Israel's experience that the lesson author feels will help us to address this question of the goal or the purpose of suffering when it happens. And let's go to Exodus 13 and verse 21. So Exodus 13, verse 21.
By day, the Lord went ahead of them in a pillar of cloud to guide them on their way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light so that they could travel by day or night.
All right. So it tells us that God had a GPS system for the Israelites, and it was a pillar of cloud in the day, a pillar of fire at night. And in so doing, God was guiding them from place to place. All right. So keeping that in mind, let's read verses 1-3.
Then the Lord said to Moses, tell the Israelites to turn back and encamp near Pi Hathirah between Middle and the sea. They are to encamp by the sea directly opposite Baal Zephon. Pharaoh will think the Israelites are wandering around the land in confusion, hemmed in by the desert.
All right. So he has them camp there by the sea. And it happens to be a trap. I think that I've been to the place. It was where I baptized one of my daughters. But there's a ridge that comes at an angle, you know, at a diagonal to the beach and ends up stopping right on the beach. And so it's like a funnel, and it's coming down south and east of Cairo, and it comes down, and you'd be funneled right into, you have the sea on the one side, the mountain on the other side, and a group would be caught. So you have here the Israelites being pursued by Pharaoh, and God leads them into what would seem like a trap. Now, before looking ahead, okay, just to test our speculative powers, perhaps, what do you think God's purpose was in taking them to that dangerous place? What do you think God would say was his purpose? He was clearly leading them, pillar of fire, pillar of cloud, but he brought them into a place where Pharaoh's army became the third side of a triangle, and they had nowhere to go, nowhere to escape. Sounds to me like you'd rather read verses 4-8. Okay, Henry, go ahead.
Well, it's very clear that God is telling Moses, this looks like a trap. So if you are told in advance, then it is not a trap, right? So I don't think that they were led there without the knowledge. That's what God is trying to make the case. From your perspective, Moses and the people, this looks like this, but it is not, because I am already telling you and I have a plan, and we need to continue reading what the plan is.
All right. So he says, tell the Israelites, turn back and camp there. They're to camp opposite that place so that Pharaoh will think. Okay. Aaron.
As much as we don't like it, it seems like God in his providence leads us to situations where there is no way out without him, so that we can learn to depend on him and so that he can show us his power in that experience and lead us to a greater level of trust and perhaps of understanding, depending on the situation.
I always wondered why the Egyptians didn't come around the pillar of fire. And then I looked at that area archaeologically, and it is actually walls on both sides. So in a sense, it was for their own protection. God could put the pillar of fire right there at the mouth of where they would come in, and they couldn't go around. So it's how you look at it, the perspective you're looking from God's perspective, a great plan of protection for the Israelites. For them, they're trapped. And so there we have it, like Aaron said, to show his power.
Yeah. And the reason for this little exercise, I mean, it's all explained in the text that follows, but the reason for the exercise is that there are times in the biblical accounts where we would end with verse 3, where you wouldn't get the explanation. And so I was just suggesting, if that were the case here, what would we think God was doing? What would we think his purpose was? Now we can test our thinking by what the text actually says. So let's go to that in verses 4-8 of chapter 14.
And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will pursue them. And I will gain glory for myself through Pharaoh and all his army, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. So the Israelites did this. When the king of Egypt was told that the people had fled, Pharaoh and his officials changed their minds about them and said, "What have we done? We have let the Israelites go and have lost their services." So he had his chariot made ready and took his army with him. He took 600 of the best chariots, along with all the other chariots of Egypt, with officers over all of them. The Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, so that he pursued the Israelites who were marching out boldly.
All right. First of all, let me just note that Pharaoh chose the equivalent of his special forces, his very, very best. 600 tanks were out there to go after the people of God and to trap them. So this is a massive response. But what do you make of the rest of this? He says, I want to show my glory. And the question is, didn't he just do that? Didn't he, in the 10 plagues, show his glory? How much more glory does he need? I guess is the question. This is the explanation. So we're trying to understand, what is God doing here? What is his purpose? And then the hardening of Pharaoh's heart. What do you make of that? Now, from a purely human perspective, what Pharaoh does is insanity. You know, he's just gone through the 10 plagues, lost the firstborn of Egypt, the devastation of crops and cattle and everything. I mean, this was horrific. And he knows where it came from, because Moses was explicit, God will do this each time. It seems almost bizarre that he would act in this way. All right, Robert Wegeman.
The hardening of the heart was Pharaoh's free choice. He didn't have to, he chose to. God created a situation where he had to make a decision. He chose badly.
Bobby Joe.
Survivors of abuse, there's like a boogeyman constantly present, creating fear for them. You know, they're always looking around, where is he? Is he still out there? Kind of fear constantly. And I think that God in his mercy took this final step to deal with the Egyptians, so that when Israel was born through the Red Sea, you can say, they were given liberty in a way that they really needed it. Because God goes on to say, the Egyptians that you've seen today, you'll see no more. So can you imagine? They get on the other side and the rejoicing they have is profound. Otherwise, when they had created their new land, they would always have the sensation or this fear that the Egyptians would come and capture them again, drag them back to Egypt, re-enslave them. But God liberates them in one complete step when he sends them across, closes the door, and doesn't allow Egypt to be a power in their life anymore.
Fascinating perspective. So you're saying if they had just left and Pharaoh had not pursued them, they would have crossed the Red Sea, but they'd still be vulnerable because he might have launched an attack while they were in the wilderness. But after the Red Sea experience, they no longer had the power to pursue. And so it increased Israel's security. Interesting. I'm not aware that the text says that, but that makes a lot of sense. Very, very interesting. Henry.
I think that what Pharaoh is experiencing is exactly the same that the people of Israel is experiencing. And God needed to do a very impressive show of his glory to convince them both. He was also after Egypt, as he has been after all of us. So the amount of glory that God was displaying did not convince the Israelites that they could trust God and did not convince Pharaoh of the opposite. Can you imagine for how many centuries the Egyptians were the superpower? And now how can this be that we have had these defeats? I think that I still have a chance. How many times have we go through that we think, I just probably can do better next time? And obviously, Pharaoh was not very knowledgeable about who God was, that insisted on the same regardless. And it's clear, not even us sometimes. God's manifestation of glory has not been enough. How many times we end up still doubting after all of that story?
So your answer to the question, weren't the 10 plagues glory enough for God? The answer is no, not because God needed more glory, but because he was trying to reach the Egyptians. And it specifically says, I think it's in verse 4, I will gain glory for myself to Egyptians, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. So he is seeking a connection with the Egyptians, and the plagues weren't enough. They didn't finish the task of convincing the Egyptians. So that was God's motivation. Now, did that inconvenience the Israelites, at least in terms of their mental state, for a short time? It certainly did. But God had a much bigger purpose in mind for all of this. All right, Lou?
I've just been finishing up the book of Ezekiel, and it goes through some horrific things that the children of Israel just over and over and over, and what they went through and what they did, the horrific things that they did. And God dealt with them very, very strongly. And every time it ends the chapter or the situation with, so that they will know that I am God. That was his whole purpose, so that they would know that he is God. And that's the same with Pharaoh and everybody he deals with. When it seems severe, that's because he wants us to know that he is God. And I think that tells me a lot about who he is, how much he loves us. He's willing to risk his reputation.
So if and when God acts in ways that cause us suffering, it is because he has our best good in mind and he has a larger purpose that we may not always understand. Michael?
Archaeologists believe that the Pharaoh, it's mentioned in Exodus, is probably Ramses III, who lived to an age of about 90 or so. He had a very long reign. And they say, well, but there's no mention of the Israelites anywhere in the hieroglyphic records and so forth. But if you study the hieroglyphic record, the Pharaoh is always regarded as this wonderful leader. He never is defeated in battle. He never has any failures. That was typical the way that the Egyptians recorded their pharaohs, except for Amenhotep IV, who was also known as Akhenaten, who believed in monotheism. But other than that, and they tried to destroy his record after his death because he had said, no, there's not a lot of gods, there's just one. And so that's just typical of the way the Egyptians maintained their records in their hieroglyphic record, that is.
Now, a very interesting piece here is that there are actually two dates for the Exodus. The popular one that you mentioned is like the late 1200s BC, but there's about a 300-year ambiguity in the records and exactly how you date some of these kings, etc. And it's interesting that if you start with the records as they are, you come out about there. But if you go to the biblical record and start that, you know, put your confidence there and then recheck the Egyptian records. Another option is about the middle of the 15th century, about 1450. And that would be a different set of kings than Ramses, etc. And it's interesting, and I've seen this with my own eyes, that in one of the tombs of the mid-15th century, there's a depiction of a body of water covered with bodies. And that could be a way of depicting what happened at the Red Sea. There's other evidences there, and I'm not an Egyptologist, so I probably should leave it right there. But there is some question about exactly when the Exodus was, and maybe some almost a 300-year difference, which is grounded in the biblical record combined with some of the pharaonic records that we have. So the exact date of the Exodus is, I think, not entirely certain. And I think a lot more correlates with the biblical accounts in the 15th century rather than the 13th. So that's something to keep looking at. Terence.
The text is clear that God wants the Egyptians to come to know him. Mm. But I also recognize that from the discussion, it seems like God is dealing with a greater purpose. Because the truth is, though this is one of many incidents where the children of Israel will have their backs to the wall, so to speak, you'll find that in the future instances, they tend to forget that God is with them. And I'm wondering if in seeking to get God be glorified, is that you will have some change of behavior. When God subdues these Egyptians, they will retreat and in essence show change of behavior. So they have a certain amount of respect or regard for God the next time they'll contemplate going up against him. And I'm wondering if God is systematically writing on the minds of the Egyptians how he operates and for them to bear this in mind. Because in the future, it seems like he has to be saying to them, look at what I did to the Egyptians. And so it's always a reference point of where God demonstrated power for their in their favor. For a bigger purpose, he's systematically writing on the minds of the Israelites how he's able to come through for them.
Yeah, well, I think we would all agree that the primary purpose of Scripture is to reveal the character of God in a variety of circumstances over many centuries. It makes the most sense that all of these stories, some of these difficult stories in the Bible, are there as illustrations of God's character in real life situations. So I think we would agree with the point that you make. Let me just offer one more thought, this whole business of hardening the hearts. The thought came to me that people who are hardened in sin are very predictable. They may think, I'm free. You know, I don't need any God. I can do whatever I want. And the reality is addicts don't do what they want. They do what the addiction tells them to do. And they are kind of helpless to do anything but what the addiction tells them to do. Pharaoh was predictable here. God knew how he would react given the realities that he was confronted with. Hardened sinners are predictable. You always know what they're going to do. And so when God says God hardened his heart, all he had to do was to create a set of circumstances and Pharaoh would just fall into line and do exactly what he wanted to do, or so he thought. And so I think that brings together the idea that God hardened Pharaoh's heart and Pharaoh hardened his own heart. About five times each are said in the context of this story at different places. God hardened his heart, Pharaoh hardened his heart. The two are both correct because God set the circumstance in which Pharaoh did his thing. And God knew that he would do his thing. So the outcome was, in a sense, inevitable once circumstances were set in motion. I'd contrast that with John 3:8, a text that's often overlooked. And for sake of time, I'll just quote it. The wind blows wherever it will. No one knows where it's coming from or where it's going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. Much of my life, I thought that was about the Holy Spirit, but it's not. It's about those who are born of the Spirit. When you're born in the Spirit, you become kind of unpredictable. When you find someone who's truly walked with God, you never quite know what they're going to do in a situation because it's likely to be so countercultural. So something to keep in mind, that hardened sinners are extremely predictable. They may think that they're free, but you can almost always tell how they're going to react in every situation. And that's what I think was happening here. Henry, go ahead now.
Just the text doesn't say that God hardened the Israelites' heart, right? Yes. Or that they didn't harden their heart. But it's exactly the same in both camps. The chosen people and the Egyptians both not acknowledging what God was trying to show to them. And I will argue that God was not attempting to create suffering against the Egyptians. He actually asked, "Could you please let my people go?" They insist, "No." And they said, "Well, if you don't let them go, I will kill your firstborn." But guess what? That is not what God did. He needed to start giving little by little, trying to convince Pharaoh, "You see, I have the power to kill your firstborn. I can do it. I don't want to do it. So what about changing the waters in blood? I'm trying to convince you. It's not my purpose to cause harm, to cause suffering." That was the choice that they made, not actually God's choice.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. As Michael mentioned earlier, there is one pharaoh who actually was a monotheist. And you wonder, you know, that's earlier than Ramses. So you wonder if maybe the Israelites had had some influence. And earlier, of course, you have the Joseph story. And the pharaoh there, it's interesting when he meets Jacob, Jacob blesses him. He has a prayer over Pharaoh. You know, that's powerful stuff. One of the reasons that God sent his people to Babylon is he'd always intended that they have influence over Babylon, but they never went. And so God says, all right, there's another way to accomplish the purpose. And so he put them in Babylon. And through Daniel, at least, there was tremendous influence. Bob.
That's kind of the same question that's being raised. And I was wondering, is there evidence that a colony that believed in God developed in Egypt? Because I believe, is it called the Septuagint that was created there? Was there kind of a colony that, I know we've always thought it was Jewish, but is there evidence there were actually some Egyptians as part of God's group there? Or is that strictly Jewish? Because it is funny that a colony of Jewish scholars developed there. It does seem like God had a lot of connections with Egypt, going back to Joseph and all the way up to Christ.
Well, we know there was a strong Jewish colony in Alexandria. That's where the famous Philo lived and wrote. So there were Jewish colonies there. There was also a temple at Elephantine, which is today Aswan. So you have a temple there, a Jewish temple with some interesting aberrations. So there were clearly, at the time of Jeremiah, a number of Israelites escaped the Babylonians and fled to Egypt and took Jeremiah with them. So there's plenty of opportunity later on for the Israelites to have further influence in Egypt. And of course, Jesus himself as a child spent some years in Egypt as well. But I don't think there's any solid influence of an Israelite influenced Egyptian religion, if that's what you're asking. Larry.
It's hard to know exactly what is implied in the hardening of Pharaoh's heart. However, when you live long enough, you have a lot of experience in this. And in my life, what I've noticed is there are times when I'm being impressed mentally to do something that's the right thing. And usually it's to be merciful or forgiving or loving. And then right about that moment, something occurs in my brain that says, no, they don't deserve it. Continue being the jerk. And you find that this struggling is going on. And early on, it was very easy to give into that. And through practice and years, that voice is still there. And yet it's easier now to do the right thing. And it comes down to there is a personal choice that is involved in this. There is the force of good and evil that is constantly there working on an individual. So it would be difficult for me to presume that Pharaoh did not have a guardian angel, an influence for good, and he chose not to listen to it because of his position and we're going to do it this way because I'm the Pharaoh and I'm tired of this and I'm going to show God who rules the earth. So, and his counselors of course, are probably encouraging him to do this. So we have all of those dynamics, but the final decision, God didn't harden his heart. As you say, God put into play a series of events that, based upon historical observations, he could predict how Pharaoh would respond and where he would go. So I always am cautious when we say God is doing this, because I think people then use that as an escape from personal responsibility. I think the personal responsibility in this is huge.
All right, Daniel.
It's interesting that in verse 8, it says that the Egyptians pursued the Israelites who were marching out boldly, some translations have defiantly. But then verse 10 says, two verses later, as Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them, and they were terrified and cried out to the Lord. You see what slavery does to your spirit. That the moment you are free, you still cannot make a decision. You don't know how to rely on God or yourself. And you start understanding why the whole generation needs to die in the wilderness. These people are not going to be able to fight the Canaanites. These people get scared. The first problem comes. The recurring refrain will be how in every crisis they just grumble and say, oh, it's somebody else's fault. It's Moses' fault. It's God's fault. But they just can't live with the reality.
Well, 85% of their spies were afraid to tackle the Canaanites, which were much less formidable people than the Egyptians. So, and you see this all the way through chapter 14. It's just amazing. The Israelites are getting nothing. They're not understanding what we see here in the text. They are continually questioning, continually afraid. So obviously, we might feel superior in reading these accounts afterward and think if we had been there, we would have done it differently. And I suspect that the Israelites were acting pretty normal, just as Pharaoh was acting normal for a hardened sinner as he was. Bobby Joe.
The promises that God made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were quite distant for the group that was exiting Egypt at that time. When Moses had shown up to take them out of Egypt, I think for them it felt sort of like Moses was showing up, he was starting to ruffle feathers, he was disrupting things, and his actions were leading to more pain on their part. It wasn't something that they signed up for. And now they are out of Egypt, and I think they're still not really buying into all this. It's really interesting because this experience, immediately after the telling of it, the first two verses of chapter 15, we see a profound paradigm shift amongst these people. It goes from referring to God as my father's God, that distant God from way back then that promised those things, to the Lord is my strength. He is my God. So it really is quite a shift. And I think the experience that God takes them through is the catalyst that allows for that paradigm shift that did not happen through the 10 plagues of Egypt.
So you're saying that God was not glorified in the Egyptians' eyes by the 10 plagues enough, but also the Israelites. It wasn't enough for them as well. So we'll go to chapter 14, verses 30 and 31, which gives us an outcome of God's trapping action that we started with here. Exodus 14, 30 and 31.
That day, the Lord saved Israel from the hands of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the shore. And when the Israelites saw the great power the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord and put their trust in him and in Moses, his servant.
All right, so in the end, after all of this, there was some response on the part of Israel, but as we will see, it was only a temporary response. And I think the lesson makes the following comment at the end. Following God's leading doesn't guarantee happy times, as one of the things one could take away from this, that they came out of Egypt, everything looked great, and suddenly in a trap, terrified, etc. But God once again came through. Let's turn to Exodus 17, verse 1. And this is part 3 of your handout. Exodus 17 and verse 1.
The whole Israelite community set out from the desert of Sin, traveling from place to place as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink.
All right, so here God was again leading them, and they were traveling together, and he brings them to a campsite that has no water. So what is God doing here? Keep that question in mind and go back to chapter 15, Exodus 15 and verses 22 to 27. Let's start with 22. Exodus 15, 22.
Then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went into the desert of Shur. For 3 days they traveled in the desert without finding water.
Okay, so this is not the first time. They went 3 days in 1522, no water. And keep in mind, this is a desert. If any of you have been to Sinai, you'll realize that there's barely a blade of weed anywhere, much less grass. It is as barren a place, I think, as you can imagine. And here they're wandering around looking for water and not finding it. So what happened in 17 is not the first time that they were without water. Let's continue verse 23.
When they came to Marah, they could not drink its water because it was bitter. That is why the place is called Marah.
All right, so finally they find water, but it's undrinkable. And what do they do? Verse 24.
So the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "What are we to drink?"
All right, there they are again. And chapter 17 repeats the story. So this is in between, by the way, you have the manna. So you have God providing water, providing manna, and then in 17, you know, back to square one. Bobby Joe.
It's interesting that God takes them through a ginormous body of water, and then he takes them to absolutely no water. Was he trying to establish that he is the God that controls water?
Interesting. Yes. Gary?
I thought that the pillar was of cloud in the day and light at night was leading them. So you say they were wandering.
Mm-hmm.
Were they wandering on their own or were they following the pillar? And if so, then that was wandering, not them.
Yeah, I was questioning that language after I said it, but I was hoping nobody noticed. But yes, I think it's clear God was leading them all through here. And I think that's why the lesson is telling these stories, that here God is leading, and yet these things happen that they would interpret as suffering. So here, yeah, he's the God of water and he's the God of no water at times. And I think I've mentioned this to you in a previous session, but when we lived in Israel for a time, we visited a place called the Biblical Landscape Preserve and got a tour from a lady who introduced herself as a Jewish New Testament scholar. Great combination for our group. I thought Sabbath keeping New Testament scholars. Anyway, but she made an interesting observation that just blew my mind. She said, you know, God could have settled his people in Egypt. And in Egypt, it never rains, but there's plenty of water just coming out of nowhere in the river. Could have settled his people in Turkey, where there's abundant rainfall and you never have to worry about it. Instead, he put his people in a land where there was barely enough water to survive, and that would mean they would have to look to heaven. They could not simply assume that everything would be okay. The Egyptians found it easy to live without God because the river would take care of them. And in Turkey, you could just, you know, the weather would take care of you, but in Israel, it would not. So, Bobby Joe.
Can you explain the significance of the placement of the comet in verse 26? Here they are not successfully finding water. And then out of the blue, Moses says to them, follow God's commandments. If you're diligent in doing so, he will not put the diseases on you which he brought on the Egyptians. I am the Lord who heals you. And then the next sentence is, then they came to Elim, where there were 12 wells of water, 70 palms, and they camped there by the waters. So what is the relationship between water and healing here? It seems like stuck right in the middle there, it has some kind of significance. And I'm just curious.
Yeah, this is one of the favorite texts, I think, people. I will heal all of your diseases. You'll have none of these diseases that the Egyptians have. And we sort of recite that as a proof text, but it's right here in the middle of this story. Now, what does it have to do with this story? We'll hold up on that for a sec. And Michael, you get your word first.
Well, just a comment about something I heard several years ago, and I don't know who said it. Moses led the children of Israel out of Egypt, and they wandered in the desert for 40 years at God's direction. and then they were taken to the only place in the Middle East that has no oil.
Probably didn't need oil back then, right? All right, Rodney.
This actually brings back to me a experience that I had from that time on. It helped me to see things in a different way. I was a freshman in high school, and like most of the Adventist school in this side of the world in South Pacific, in especially in Papua New Guinea, we have to resist ourselves with certain requirements in an Adventist school. Like we need to have a Bible, make sure we have a Bible. We have to have some tools to work in the farm and all these sort of things. Well, one Friday I was surprised that my Sabbath clothes were stolen from the line, and a person that was trying to help myself in the school and working, I was so devastated. But then the wife of the dean, who never knew me, sent a message to the dorm and said, please call Rodney to come to me. So I went. Hesitatingly, I went to the wife of the dean, and therein, in her home, she had a bucket full of the exact things that I lost from the line. Mm. And they were Sabbath clothes. They were actually new, newer than what I had. Mm. So when I see this, I easily question why 3 days into the wilderness, and then the Bible does not really say it here, but I think it took a day for them to reach Elim, where there were 70 palm trees and 12 worlds of water. So I'm seeing God moving them through a time of suffering, and then on the other end, he is providing abundance. So relating back to my experience, from that time on, I've learned that whenever I come to a time where I am being challenged, I am now going to look for what the Lord is gonna prepare on the other side. It's just like a perspective that when I come through the brick wall, I'm very anxious because I know that blessing is a day ahead. That perspective have helped me to see challenges in a different way, to embrace them, because it comes with a load of blessing. Thank you.
Thank you. Ashley, would you read verses 25 to 27? We've been talking about them. Let's take a look directly.
Then Moses cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a piece of wood. He threw it into the water, and the water became sweet. There the Lord made a decree and a law for them, and there he tested them. He said, if you listen carefully to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his eyes, if you pay attention to his commands and keep all his decrees, I will not bring on you any of the diseases I brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. Then they came to Elim, where there were 12 springs and 70 palm trees, and they camped there near the water.
All right, nice. I see those 70 palm trees. Keep in mind, I've experienced in Egypt temperatures as high as 122 degrees. It is a very, very hot place, very little shade. So it's not only the water, but finding all those palm trees would have had a tremendous comforting effect on the people that were there. So we have this as a background. Let's go back to chapter 17 now, in verse 1, once again.
The whole Israelite community set out from the desert of Sin, traveling from place to place as the Lord had commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink.
All right, so once again, we have a situation of being led by the pillar of cloud to a place that has no water. And you will remember, of course, that that was happening also in chapter 15. So notice verse 2 here.
So they quarreled with Moses and said, give us water to drink. Moses replied, why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord to the test?
You'll notice that in chapter 15, it says that God was putting them to the test. And now they are putting God to the test. So that's an interesting irony here. Let's read verse 3.
But the people were thirsty for water there, and they grumbled against Moses. They said, why did you bring us up out of Egypt to make us and our children and livestock die of thirst?
All right. Wasn't that long ago? You had Marah, and then after Marah, the 70 palm trees. That's context for chapter 15. So the Israelites clearly were having difficulty getting the message about who God is. And I think maybe that's something to remind us of how difficult it is for sinful human beings to grasp a genuinely gracious God. There's something ingrained in us to fear the worst, I think, about authority of any kind. Larry?
Their original ancestor, Abraham, he gets tested, and there's, in many cases, 15 years between a recorded testing and another one. And here, in rapid succession, God is trying to jolt them awake, I'm going to say, because they don't have a long time from the time of the Red Sea until the time they're going to be going and scouring out the land to get ready to take it over, on the first attempt anyway. So there's a lot of things, a lot of lessons that the leaders and the people need to understand in a really short period of time. And when I've experienced things like that in my life, they can be very traumatic and unsettling. So I'm just wondering how that plays into part of this story.
Yeah, I actually find some sympathy with the Israelites, because as I look back on my life, realizing how many things I could have known much sooner, but did not. And part of it was simply what we would call perhaps a mental block. Sometimes we're set in certain ways of thinking that we can't see the obvious. And times when you'll see a Bible text, and like John 3:8, read it 100 times until a friend of mine pointed out, this is not about the Holy Spirit. The obvious was not visible to me. So the Israelites are kind of like us who have mental blocks about certain biblical texts that we're not yet ready for. And I remember Jesus in John 16 saying, I have many things to tell you, but you're not ready for them now. Gary?
Looking back, a tendency, and I have to admit that I have this attitude, is why did they have such problems? I mean, he parted the Red Sea, he had the pillar of cloud and pillar of fire, he made the water pure and all these kinds of things. And then I got to thinking, well, they were used to the Egyptian gods, and pagan gods are inconsistent. You have to keep bribing them or having to keep doing something for them to be favorable to them. So the concept that the God that was leading them out was always in their favor and would always be like that. So I think maybe that's part of the problem, is why the obvious care that they had had before didn't carry over into the future, because they were used to gods that could change their face for whatever reason.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we sometimes think of the Israelites as uniquely stupid. I prefer to see them and the Egyptians as a whole lot like us, and the challenges that we may have in figuring some things out. After all, they had been slaves for a while, so they did have a certain programmed kind of thinking that didn't help. But I like to see the biblical stories as people a lot like us, people where if we were in those situations might make the same decisions. And that, I think, helps maybe get a handle on what the scriptures are actually saying to us. Ashley?
Well, to Larry's point, they definitely were getting an intensive course in out there in the desert. And one thing you're at least told to do in school is to review, like right after you are told something, to like, you know, review it right after and then review it later. And the repetition more likely to be like long-term memory. So I suppose in a way, maybe these like, yeah, rapid succession of very significant events maybe is a teaching strategy in a way that God clearly wanted them to get a message drilled into their head.
It's interesting, and I think I've mentioned this once before. We had an Israeli, he's kind of a business operator type and stuff, and he was just talking about how people learn. And he asked the question, he says, what is the most memorable thing that's happened in your lifetime? And we were all just going to discuss it privately and then share. And pretty much everybody of a certain age said Kennedy's assassination, and the younger ones said September 11. And then he pointed out, you notice that both of those are very traumatic events. He says the body naturally remembers trauma before it remembers the good things. There's almost an inherent thing that we do, that the traumatic events trigger memory and they stay there and have a deeper impact. God may never enjoy a suffering, and yet God would know that there are times we won't learn any other way. One reason for testing. Many students are terrified by tests. But as a result, those little traumas mean that that information will be more accessible to them in years after. So he basically said teachers don't shy away from giving students traumatic experiences because in the right context, it actually helps the memory. Bob?
We've talked a little bit about the disadvantages that came out of Israel being in slavery. Are there any good things that occurred because Israel went through slavery? Is there any positives?
So what's the bright side of slavery, Bob? That's a very interesting question. Can you think of any? Because I can't at the moment.
Not really.
Okay. Yeah.
But I was trying to figure, was that inevitable? And God said, no, they need to go through slavery for some reason because they were kind of brought into it because of the famine going way back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, in favor of your suggestion that maybe there was something good in it, you do have the prophecy that God gave to Abraham. The slavery in Egypt was prophesied, and so was the captivity in Babylon. With Babylon, we know that they didn't have to go. The captivity was a last resort because God was constantly interceding with prophet after prophet to say, you won't have to go if you simply do this. And so they did not. With Israelites going down to Egypt, it seems more circumstantial, and the prophecy is not a conditional one as such, but simply saying this is what's going to happen. So interesting thought. I see three more hands. Let's just hold off for a minute because we've been talking about Exodus 17, but haven't finished the text, verses 4 through 7 of Exodus 17, and then we'll go back to our discussion.
Then Moses cried out to the Lord, "What am I to do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord answered Moses, "Walk on ahead of the people. Take with you some of the elders of Israel and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will stand there before you by the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock and water will come out of it for the people to drink." So Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel, and he called the place Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?"
Yeah, just an observation. In spite of all of these interventions of God, they still doubted whether God was really with them or not. And at first glance, you say, that is so stupid. And then think further. Have there been times in your life when you had a tremendous sense of God's presence, and 12 or 24 hours later, when something struck, it was all gone? How quickly we forget. The Israelites, I think, are maybe more like us than we would like to think. All right, Henry.
About the slavery comment, was God's mention of the 400 years of slavery to Abraham a prophecy, or was that a warning? At least from my perspective, it was their choice to remain in Egypt once the famine was over. They were given a land. They didn't have to stay there. They just went there because of the famine to show God's glory and mercy to them and to the Egyptians. The mission was accomplished. Pharaoh at that time believed in God. And everything was fine for them to leave Egypt and go back to what they were supposed to be. Their comfort, their sense of comfort and staying in Egypt is what led them to become slaves. And obviously, God took advantage of that abuse to show again how loving and reliable he is, that what he promised, in spite that it was not his plan, that he was ready to deliver them from there.
So I hear you saying that you would see that as a conditional prophecy.
Or a warning, more than a conditional prophecy, a warning. Mm-hmm. Like when we tell our children, when we are raising them, don't cross the street without looking at the signs because you will be run over by a car. You are not trying to prophesy anything, right? Or if you continue smoking, you will develop cancer. So you're not trying to prophesy. You are warning people to do not continue in that direction.
Okay, I think that's worth thinking about. To me, it does seem to read more like a prophecy. But here's the point. In Jeremiah 18, God says, whenever I speak positively about any nation or any entity and they turn from me, the good things I plan to do won't happen. And anytime I say to a nation or an entity, you're going to be destroyed, and they repent and come back to me, I won't do the things that I promised. You know? So I think we sometimes forget that there's a general statement that most prophecies are conditional. And so I like your point that while it turned out that they were the 400 years, you know, it turned out exactly that way. You're suggesting it didn't have to be that way. I think that's sending us in the right direction. So prophecy sometimes is a warning. Certainly that's what happened with the Assyrians in Jonah. It was a prophecy, but it was also a warning. And the Assyrians took the warning seriously and repented, and it didn't happen. And then Jonah was moaning that he was considered a false prophet. So, very good. All right, our time is just about up. Let us go to Luke 4 and look at one more time when God leads one of his own into what appears to them to be perhaps suffering. And that's the story of Jesus' temptation. Let's read first just verses 1 and 2, and then we'll pause there for a moment and then read the whole thing. Luke 4, 1 to 13, but first 1 and 2.
Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry.
There's an explicit connection in the Gospels between the life of Jesus and the experience of Israel. And that included being in the desert for a period of 40 days for Jesus, 40 years for the Israelites. So this parallel is being carried out here. So the Israelite story, I think, is rightly being connected to Luke 4. But the piece that I want you to notice says, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the desert. So Jesus didn't wander into the desert. He was led there to a place with no water and with no food, similar to the kinds of things we were seeing in the book of Exodus. Mark is even stronger. It says the Holy Spirit drove him into the wilderness, a language of compulsion almost. With that in mind, read verses 1 to 13.
Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone." The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. So if you worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." The devil led him to Jerusalem, had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered, "It says, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time.
Now, there's lots of fun things we could have done with this text. For example, asking the question, what's wrong with creating bread? Or the question, why always scripture? Why is Jesus always quoting scripture? Or noticing that in the Greek, the word for test and the word for temptation is the same. So sometimes you see in the Bible, God never tempts anyone, and then it'll say God tested them. Well, that's an English, you know, distinction. In the original, it's the same word. So we could have had fun discussing, you know, when is something a test and when is it a temptation? But our time is just about up. So I want to throw a different question to you. Why did the Holy Spirit lead Jesus into this traumatic experience? We have just a couple of minutes. So there's time for one or two of you if you'd like to take a shot at it. If not, let me just give quickly my own thought, and then I'll let Iris have the last word. And the thought is this. This is evidence in the cosmic conflict. This is a very crucial story that's part of all that. And I think that needs to be kept in mind with everything we've been doing this week and also last week, as we're wrestling with, you know, why is God doing this or why is he allowing that, etc., to always realize that it's not just about Israel. It's not just about the Egyptians. It's about a much larger conflict. And that is a context in which the same questions need to be addressed. And often in that context, what God is doing makes a lot more sense. All right, Iris?
Yeah, I would
like to second that, especially in the Gospel of Mark. It says that immediately after the baptism, Jesus turned to this head-on confrontation with Satan in the desert. And it really has everything to do with the fact that he was on a mission. He came with a purpose to this world. The purpose was, of course, to reveal the Father and the love of the Father and the character of God to us. But even more so, since we had fallen into the bondage of Satan, he was on a large rescue mission. And the only way he could accomplish that was to challenge the adversary and to win the authority over the human race again. That is what he came to do. This is what he lived. This is what he died for. And this is what he accomplished on the cross. And the beginning of that head-on confrontation happened in those 40 days in the wilderness when Satan tried to do him in. And he couldn't. And because he couldn't, there's hope for us.
So again, much larger battle going on. Yeah. Gary?
I'm sure that he knew the great controversy issue, and he knew the devil and all this, but this made it very real. He was going to begin his ministry. And right up front, he has a very strong, vivid, not theoretical, but actual confrontation with who he was up against. And so I think that was sort of a confirmation to what it was that he was trying to show was not correct in his accusations about God and the kinds of methods that he would use and all this. So I think it was a confirmation, and if maybe for, we would say, an awakening, or adding to the fact that this is what he was up against.
Okay, thank you. Michael, you truly have the last word. Go ahead.
This is raises a question I thought about a great deal. It's a real conundrum. Jesus was true God. He pre-existed anything that was created, and yet he was true man. And I've often thought about, how did he accomplish this? How did he hide himself from himself? In other words, if he was true God, these weren't real temptations. But he was a true man, and they were temptations. Real temptations, the kinds of things that would befront us. And was he hungry? Yes, he was hungry. Was he thirsty? He was truly thirsty. He really was. And how that was accomplished, I haven't got a clue. He was true God and true man, and he knew what he was doing. And some questions I don't know the answer.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much for those thoughts. And we recognize that in all of this, there's much more than what we know. And I think that's an excellent point to remind us. I'm grateful that we were able to have this time together and to ponder some of these challenging things. And I'm deeply grateful for how God uses each one of you to add a facet to the story that might not be there without you. So thank you very much. And let's pray as we close. Dear Lord, you have been good to us today in opening your word, opening our minds, opening our hearts. And I pray that you would continue with us in the week to come. May we know you and walk with you, for Jesus' sake. Amen.